Right now it is time for Main Street Magazine on Robin Hood Radio. Of course, you can find Main Street Magazine throughout our tri-state region at various pickup points where the magazine is absolutely free. And of course, they have their matching companion on the web, which is mainstreetmag.org. And once again, we welcome in Thorin. Thorin, nice to speak to you this morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Good. How was your Thanksgiving?
It was nice to get a few days off. How about you?
It was, I didn't get day off, but you know what was nice about it? And this is going to sound strange. There was no pressure to go anyplace.
Right.
I just sit in my house, eat my turkey, watch my football, and not as, so it was actually kind of calming and relaxing, not worrying about having people call you and invite you to their houses and stuff like that. So in a strange way, it was kind of nice, you know?
That's good.
Yeah. And I'm sure, like I said, since this COVID-19 crisis, my sons and daughters, who now have all families, find it, the kids love it for one reason. Instead of hopping around from place to place, they just stay home. There's a quandary there. But of course, we all wish that we still had the freedoms that we used to have. But you have your December issue online, and is it out at the different locations as well?
It is. We actually got it delivered Friday morning, and Libby, I don't know, for those who saw our social media post, you know, the big man himself came and delivered the issues, and so she got them out, and Griffin started yesterday as well, so we're just about everywhere.
Well, that's great, and I'm going to start off with food, simply because it's the holidays, and food is terrific, all right? I saw a recipe for something that I'm going to try. I have some leftover turkey, and it was if you take egg roll wrapper and don't fry it. Take an egg roll wrapper, in it put a little bit of stuffing, a little bit of turkey, a little bit of cranberry sauce. You fold it up and everything. Put it in your no-fry fryer, which is basically a convection oven, for about 12 minutes. And you get an incredible Thanksgiving egg roll.
Nice.
And, yes, because you have the egg roll, there's about 80 or 90 additional calories. But if you were to make that a sandwich, you'd have 300 calories of bread, 150 calories a slice, plus what was in it. So it's a great way to use some of your leftovers. Now,
nice.
With that being said, I had to laugh when I saw the upside down cake by Jesse Sheehan. I never understood it as a kid watching my grandmother and her sisters make this cake. And then all of a sudden, when it was made, praying to the heavens as they flipped it over onto this big plate that it would all hold. And I just remembered that it was so funny back then watching them flip it over. But upside down cakes really are fun to eat and also fun to watch being made.
Yeah, so I have never made, I will admit, I've never made an upside down cake. So I too had enjoyed reading through Jessie's Meyer Lemon upside down cake and how she explains the you know, you kind of put the decoration at the bottom and then you don't see it until you flip it over and then you hope it looks nice. So it's kind of a interesting concept, but, you know, it looks beautiful and by all accounts, she says it tastes amazing. So something, you know, perhaps to consider and something different.
Well, the great thing about upside down cakes, speaking as somebody who no longer eats them, is that the caramelization that takes place on the bottom.
Yes.
That all of a sudden comes up on the top. It's like creme brulee. When you get that sugar caramelization, it's addicting. It's just unbelievably well. So that's the great thing I love about the upside down cakes. Now, this issue, is it a healthy holiday issue? Is that what you refer to it as?
No, it was just our holiday issue. Okay. It's our first kind of official holiday themed issue. So we try to kind of, you know, have everything focused kind of on something related to the holidays.
Now, you have another article that interests me a ton simply because I haven't golfed in years. But as a golfer, up until we started this radio station, when I used to be able to have time to golf, I would golf a lot, 3 or 4 times a week. And you have a story because I have friends that golfed, as a matter of fact, locally on Sunday. Which is mm-hmm. late into the season when you can golf
right.
a little bit after Thanksgiving. But you've got a great story, The Golf Course Dream, Not a Foregone Conclusion. And you, part of that story is a Stony Brook golf course in Litchfield for sale for $2.75 million. But this is a terrific story for people that don't understand the business side of golf.
Right. So Christine, first of all, let's give her credit for her puns, which are always good. But this is our monthly real estate feature, and she kind of pitched the idea a couple months back, like, "Hey, what if we look at the real estate of golf courses?" And as she and I said, well, that's a incredibly niche market of real estate, but let's take a look. And so she kind of goes through a few of the golf courses in our tri-state region and talks about the ups and downs of it and what's involved in not just the real estate portion, but how the business affects it and how that affects the real estate of it. And specifically in our region, while she does mention a couple of national sales, but it's, I forget the figure actually, but she mentioned how many sales were of golf courses, I think last year or the year before, and there are not very many in the whole country. So it's a very, can we say, exclusive type of real estate. And it makes you kind of, if you ever had a pipe dream of, owning a golf course, this is something for you to read.
Well, what's interesting about this article on golf is that in our area, we have within immediate vicinity of us right here in Sharon and Millerton, you have as public courses Hotchkiss, the Canaan Country Club, Quarry View, Hunter Mountain Golf Course, Copaic, and Meadow Greens. Okay. Those are just the public ones, but then you have the private ones. And if any, what they've done at Silo Ridge is truly unbelievable.
Yes.
I've gotten to see what they've done with their golf course and what they've done with the amenities that go with the golf course.
Oh, incredible.
It's jaw-dropping. You
Yes.
I think you could probably travel anywhere in the country, the finest resorts, and not have the amenities that people who are going to be at Silo Ridge, which is private, by the way, are going to find. It is truly spectacular and amazing.
It is. I drive by there 4 times a day, and it's, something to see all that construction, and it'll be something when it's all finished, but it's already something right now.
Yeah, it's so that's what make that story so interesting. And then I have to do this, folks. And yes, Robin Hood Radio, Tri-State Public Communications, owns and operates Robin Hood Radio, the local access television outfit in North Canaan, and the Bargain Barn in Sharon, as a 501c3. It raises funds for us. And you have a great story called What a Deal, the Bargain Barn in Sharon, Connecticut. And your author of the story did a nice job with pictures and also explaining what the store is, how it operates, how it deals with COVID, the staff, and everything like that.
Thank you. Well, you can probably tell us much more than what we read here, but Christine opted to have this be our entrepreneur feature of the month. Normally, we feature either a business or a business owner, and sometimes not-for-profit such as this. So in this case, she actually talked to the manager, the employees, I guess, the volunteers, as well as some of the customers there. And that's how she put this piece together on it. But, for those who aren't aware of it, I knew a little bit, but I didn't know a lot, admittedly. And I learned quite a bit about the operation and what you guys do, what you offer, and how it all works. So I hope that the readers find it informative and are, come on over and shop and support a good cause, as well as, consider donations when they're doing a little house cleaning.
It really, when we took it over, it was basically simply because it was at that time over a 50-year tradition, and it's more than just a thrift shop. Yeah, it's always raised money. It used to raise money for the Sharon Hospital. It was a non-for-profit, way back when, and then when it became private, is when it was switched over. But the great thing about it is a social meeting place. People come there, especially on the weekends, and they see other friends and neighbors. And
That's
yes,
great.
it's changed a little bit during COVID-19 because you can only allow a certain amount of people in. But still, it would have been a huge loss to the community as a whole. And that's the reason we took it over. But it's a lot of fun to operate. And the people that work there and volunteer there are absolutely amazing the job they do. So I will go on to one other story because we just have a few minutes left, and that is the spirit of giving, persevering to feed others.
So Griffin and I discussed when we were planning this issue, you know, what it is that is important during the holidays, and you know, we didn't want to just talk about, oh, the, you know, what's the latest trend this year, what all the kids want, but the things that actually are important during the holidays, and what the Christmas spirit means and the holiday spirit, not just Christmas, I suppose. And so we decided to feature some of the food pantries and address a little bit of the food insecurities that a lot of people have been experiencing, you know, this year in particular, and then leading up to the holidays. So he reached out to a few of the food pantries in the tri-state region and shares kind of their, you know, a little bit of piece of who they are and how they operate, and then how COVID has affected them and the families that they feed. And you know, they give, you know, some of the numbers of, you know, what you know, like in the one in Great Barrington, how the state of Massachusetts has stepped in to help them, and then others talk about how many turkeys they normally get allotted, and they get allotted less, it got allotted less this year. However, they had more inquiries or, you know, applications for turkeys this year. So it's you know, it's for those who, you know, want to do something this holiday season to make a difference in people's lives, you know, I implore you to, you know, consider giving food to local food pantries and helping out a bit, and just, you know, or reading the story and understanding what is involved.
Yeah, most of their needs are up almost 30 to 35%. And
Yes.
we have been associated with the Sunday in the Country Food Drive for many, many years. Over the past 25 years, it's raised well over $500,000 worth of food that they distribute on Christmas and also on Thanksgiving. This year, which they distribute through food pantries, by the way, this year, over for the first Thanksgiving, over 700 turkeys, and they accumulated almost 3 tons of canned goods.
Wow.
And people can donate to them at SundayInTheCountryFoodDrive.org. They're 501c3, not for profit. But yeah, it's amazing how the different food pantries and the different churches in our area strive to serve everybody. And you know what? They don't ask about income. They don't ask about anything else. If you need food and you show up, you get it. And that's just
Exactly.
an amazing thing. Well, it's going to be a busy month. Your magazine is out all throughout the tri-state region, Main Street Magazine and mainstreetmag.com. We'll speak to you next week, Thorin.
Sounds good. Stay warm.
Take care. Main Street Magazine on Robin Hood Radio. Once again, you can find them at mainstreetmag.com on the web and throughout the tri-state region at various pickup locations.